Ah, spring has sprung. Rivers dance freely. Life awakens from gentle slumber. A symphony of birdsong heralds the dawn. Buds burst into bloom, and you look upon it all. And you sneeze, and your eyes get itchy, and your throat is scratchy. You know what? It's hay fever season, goddammit. Luckily for allergy sufferers, there is a solution. Antihistamines. Now, these drugs are great at stopping your allergies, and some can even help you with motion sickness and heartburn too. Their names all end in ene, like loratadine, cetirizine, ranitidine, fenofexadine, but you may also know them by their brand names like Benadryl, Claritin, Zyrtec, and Allegra. I'll tell you all about them today, how they work, their side effects, how they were discovered, and even, for you geeks, how they really work. So feel free to choose whichever chapter you want from the links below. I'm here all week, it's a funny joke, please don't go watch the rest of this video. Why do you need it? Well, most people use it to treat itchiness and allergies, things like hay fever, conjunctivitis, and reactions to bites and stings, including you, stinging nettles. It can also be used to treat motion sickness and nausea. They tend to be divided into two groups, the drowsy ones and the non-drowsy ones, that is to say, the older ones and the newer ones. They come in different forms, and there's not really any difference between tablets, capsules and liquids, but antihistamine cream is pretty good at those local action for those stings. There's no optimal time of day to take them, but it makes sense to take the drowsy ones at night time. Practically speaking though, if you have ongoing allergies, consistency is key, so the same time every day. In order to understand how antihistamines work, we need to learn what they're anti. We need to know what histamine is, and we need to know about allergies. Firstly, although I have to say this, if you have serious allergies, ones where your lips swell, your tongue gets big, or it makes it hard for you to breathe, do not watch this video. Go see your doctor. You probably need an EpiPen. But if you have hay fevery things and hivey stuff, then do carry on watching. So what are antihistamines? Well, they're little nitrogen compounds released by some of your white cells as an immune response, i.e. against infection. It does helpful things like cause your blood vessels to dilate, increases warmth and increases swelling, all things that can help you when you have an injury or infection. They also play a role in the stomach, where they help to release stomach acid. You can find out about that in that video up there. Finally, they're also neurotransmitters. They help to regulate your sleep-wake cycle, appetite, and general cognition. So that's all good and everything, and it's normal, but then you have allergies. Now, allergies are a hypersensitive immune response to substances which should really be harmless to you. Things like pollen, dust mites, cat hair, nuts, milk, latex, and of course some medications, especially penicillins. Why? Well, it's complicated. It's probably a bit of both nature and nurture. Genetic-wise, if your parents both had allergies, you're more likely to have them too. There's lots of theories around environment. The hygiene hypothesis says we're so clean now that we don't get exposed to things when our body is young and learning, and so has an overreaction later in life. Urban living means less diversity, less microbes. Air pollution may enhance allergies. Diet, physical activities, even your gut microbiome may all play their parts. As I say, it's complicated, and the reality is there's probably not much you can do about it anyway. It's just a good thing to know. And this brings us back to histamine, because when you have an allergy, those same helpful white cells, which were great before, have an inappropriate response to the allergen. They release their histamine and cause that swelling, that leakiness, that itchiness all around where the allergen is. Washing powder on your skin? Itchiness. Allergy on food? Tingling in your mouth, stomach pain. Hay fever? Pollen in your face? Itchy eyes, runny nose. And more generally, a bit of systemic inflammation that can make you feel a bit and knackered. So antihistamines, right? We want to stop all that crap. So let's get a bit more specific. You have two types of histamine receptor, H1 and H2. Now, H2 are most often found in the stomach lining, so antihistamines like ranitidine, which block these receptors, help to reduce stomach acid production. Good if you have reflux or peptic ulcers. H1 receptors are more widespread. They're in the brain, the smooth muscle, blood vessels, guts and lungs. So antihistamines either work on H1 or H2 receptors, and we can subdivide H1 into first generation and second generation. First generation ones are pretty good, but they do cross the blood-brain barrier. That can lead to drowsiness. So first generation antihistamines are known as the drowsy ones. And that's not always a bad thing, because if you want an anti-sickness drug, for example, you need to cross that blood-brain barrier, and drugs like Dramamine will do that. second generation antihistamines do not cross the blood-brain barrier, so they're better for daytime use. That's your loratadine, cetirizine. But of course, blocking histamines does come with side effects. Now, we've broken antihistamines down into a few groups, and we can begin to see where they act and what their side effects might be. First-gen antihistamines cross the blood-brain barrier, so they have more of an effect up here. That means they can lead to sedation and drowsiness. These drugs also interact with other receptors called cholinergic receptors, and they're all over the body too. Blocking them can lead to a dry mouth, nose, throat, slight blurred vision, constipation, even urine issues, though those last two are pretty rare. Second generation antihistamines have a much better side effect profile. They can cause mild drowsiness in a few people and can cause a headache though we don't really know why. H2 receptor antihistamines are generally well tolerated too. They can cause altered bowel movements and some people complain of dizziness and headaches or aches, but ultimately they're pretty good. Very occasionally there are some less common and severe side effects like you get with any drug, but I'm not going to touch on those today. As always though, if you don't feel right when you're taking your medication, just talk with your doctor. To understand how antihistamines came about, we need to pull together several different theories through time, which eventually make up the whole. We start with allergy, and it makes most sense that we start there with the most obvious, the big one, severe allergy, that's anaphylaxis. In 1902, a scientist called Charles Rickett was interested in injecting proteins into animals. He started with some pretty vanilla proteins, but eventually went nuclear and used the toxins of a Portuguese man-of-war jellyfish and tentacles of a sea anemone. Putting it in an animal for the first time, it was actually okay. But if he came back a few days or weeks later and did the same thing again, they had a massive reaction and often died. This is the antithesis of prophylaxis, i.e. anaphylaxis. We now know this reaction is called a type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. It's an overexpression of the immune system. The first time you get infected with something, it takes a while to fight it off when your body produces antibodies which remember it, so that the next time you get it, that same bug, you fight it off super fast. Your body knows what it's dealing with. That's why kids get sick a lot more than adults, because in adults your body remembers the infection you got when you were young. Now, with these experiments, the animals, they were getting sensitized to the proteins in the toxins. The first time they were exposed to it, it didn't really do much, but they produced antibodies which remember. Then the next time they were injected, they had a massive reaction, a hypersensitive reaction. When that reaction is really bad, it's called anaphylaxis. Now, Rickett thought this was only poisons that did this, but a year later, a French immunologist called Nicolas Artus showed that you could do it with other things too. He was able to create little reactions on the skin, something which we still call the Artus reaction today. In 1905, the term allergy came about. Austrians Clemens von Piriket and Bela Schick noticed that if they gave an antitoxin to their patients, about 6 to 12 days later, they'd complain of fever, joint swelling, pain, widespread rash. If they gave the antitoxin a second time, the reaction was much more rapid, and some patients even died. This looks like what they'd heard of as anaphylaxis, but unlike Rickett, who thought that the immune system was dampening down, the Austrians thought something had changed in between injections and their patients had become hypersensitive. They coined the term from the Greek allos, meaning other, and ergos, meaning work, so other work. About this time, antibodies were discovered and another scientist called Alfred Wolf Iser realized that pollen caused hay fever and that this was actually an allergic reaction. And in the decades following this, a lot of research went into cellular investigation of allergy and anaphylaxis and the immunology of hypersensitivity. We learned about an antibody called IgE, we learned about mast cells, and we learned they're full of granules which can be released in infection or allergy. And one of those granules is called histamine. Histamine was actually something that had already been discovered in parallel to all the allergy stuff. In 1904, Sir Henry Dale was appointed to a research post at Sir Henry Wellcome's lab. He was asked to work with parasitic mold called ergot, which grows on rye and had been responsible for an illness called St. Anthony's fire. Working on ergot derived several compounds. One was histamine, one was acetylcholine. The two molecules are actually pretty similar, which is why if you go back to the side effects section, you'll remember that antihistamines have some anticholinergic effect as well. Now, Dale set out to explore the biological action of histamine. He showed that histamine caused constriction of guinea pig ileums in here, and that it could induce shock-like syndrome when injected into mammals. It constricted the lungs and the heart. Because they saw this, they figured out that this was an anaphylactic reaction, was probably caused by the cells breaking down and releasing histamine. Parallel to all of this, a lot of discoveries were happening in the receptor field. Now, I'm not going to go into that because it's super long and this is long enough. But we figured out that histamine has its effect when it binds to a receptor. So blocking that receptor could block histamine. The race was on, and it began in the Pasteur Institute in the 1930s. The parent compound was thymoxyethyldiethylamine, and you could derive chemicals off this which could inhibit histamine, the most effective of them being 2-isopropyl-5-methylphenoxyethyldiethylamine. Luckily, they also called that 929F, which is much easier to say. The team had been working on alkaloids which affect acetylcholine, but a scientist called Daniel Beauvais asked his student Anne-Marie Staub to test these compounds against histamine. 929F protected guinea pigs from anaphylaxis, but it was pretty toxic. More chemicals were found, more were effective, more were toxic, but in 1942, the first effective antihistamine, phenbenzamine, was discovered. A whole lot of other drugs were discovered in rapid succession, including diphenhydramine or Benadryl. From that point on, antihistamines became extremely popular for treating allergy and itchiness. In 1981, the first second generation antihistamine was produced. And in 1993, fexofenadine or Allegra became a third generation antihistamine, even more targeted with a smaller side effect profile. Arguably, fourth generation antihistamines are teasing their way into our pharmacy shelves at the moment. This histamine H1 receptor is a member of the superfamily of G protein coupled receptors. These are cellular switches which exist in an equilibrium between inactive off and active on states. The H1 receptor is primed to turn on when histamine hits it. H1 antihistamines don't actually block the receptor like we've seen other drugs do in other videos. Instead, they bind to it properly. But instead of turning them on, like histamine does, they have the opposite effect and turn it off. Therefore, antihistamines are not receptor antagonists, but are inverse agonists, swinging the switch to the off position. Different ones have different properties and some linger longer than others. As we've said, one of the problems was crossing the blood-brain barrier, which is a selectively permeable barrier separating circulating blood from the fluid around your brain and spinal cord. It's tightly packed and has tight junctions and most things can't get through. Antihistamines could though. Second generation antihistamines are designed not to cross. They are less fat soluble, which makes it hard for them to diffuse across. They're bigger, so they get blocked. They're polar, which repels the lipids in the blood-brain barrier, and they're more targeted for peripheral rather than central H1 receptors. So those are antihistamines, nice drugs to have so that you can watch Wimbledon without sneezing and crying. Plenty more drug explainers on this channel, all kinds of fun stuff as well. So take care, stay healthy, do subscribe, it does help, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.